Welcome again to another Bible study. Praise God. We thank God tonight for his goodness. Thank him for his loving kindness. Thank him for just being blessed. Praise God. And we just praise him today for all things. I hope you have had a wonderful day in the Lord. Praise God, because God has been good to us. Gave his precious son, didn't he? And son gave his life. Praise God. And we thank God today for all things. That's praising continually. The Bible said that the praises of the Lord should continually come from my mouth, from my lips, that we should give God the glory that he deserves, and only him. No man, no woman, no thing, no event. God is the one that we should give the glory to, and understand that he is the one that is awesome. He's an awesome God, isn't he? He's an awesome God when you really think about the things that he has done for us, how he delivered us through his son, Jesus Christ, from sin and shame. Jesus paid my sin debt. We should always remember that. My debt was paid by Jesus Christ. My debt was paid upon that cross. Praise God. And I'm no longer owe that sin debt. And because of that, I'm going to worship him. I'm going to praise him and thank God, because God, think about it. God made a way. God made a way for us. And we thank him today for just being all that he is. We're going to praise him and give him the glory. Psalms 4:4 tells us to stand in awe. It tells us to stand in awe and sin not, and commune with your own hearts upon your beds and be still. It tells us to commune unto God. It says, offer the sacrifice of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. And so we thank God tonight, because that's what we're going to do. We're going to stand in awe of this God. We're going to continue to commune with him with our hearts. Praise God. Because that's the place God wants to have communion with, our heart. Praise the Lord. And we're going to offer to him the sacrifice of righteousness, the sacrifice of righteousness. Because God is good, and we're going to walk and continue to put our trust in him. So we thank God tonight for all things. Let us pray at this time. Father God, we bless your name, and we thank you for your goodness, Lord. We thank you for watching over us. We thank you for keeping us, Lord God. We're thankful, Lord God, on a constant basis and a daily basis, Lord God. We come before your presence with thanksgiving, and we thank you, Lord God, as you continue to touch us, Lord God, in this season. We love you for all that you continue to do. We thank you for you giving your son, and son gave his life for me and for you, for me and for all the people that are listening tonight, that we could have relationship with you. We could now be called sons and daughters. Called sons and daughters. Hallelujah. And we thank you tonight, for you are our God. You are our God. And we're going to stand in trust and hope in you. We're believing you for all things, because you are our provider, you are our way maker, and we understand that there is nothing too hard for you, and you have a covenant with the righteous, Lord God. So we come before your presence tonight, whatever the situation, whatever the circumstances tonight, we lay it at your feet. We come boldly to the throne of grace, boldly to the throne of grace. The word of God says it's a place where we can receive mercy and we can receive help. We come boldly before your throne tonight. We come boldly before your throne, Lord. We come before you with prayers and righteousness. We pray for this world that we live in. We pray for men, praise God, and the hearts of men. Praise the Lord. We pray for this world, Lord God, that you would touch hearts and minds, Lord, because you sent your son gave his life for this world. And we pray that men will see you and understand who you are, Lord God. We ask that you touch us, that we be your witnesses, we be your ambassadors, Lord God, that we be your written epistles, Lord God, that we can go forth with boldness into our communities, Lord God, into our neighborhoods, Lord God. And we can go forth, Lord God, in the ways that you have made possible for us to witness for you in this time that we live in. We were born, hallelujah, for a time such as this. We were born for a time such as this right now. And our purpose and our mission is to lift you up. Our purpose and our mission is to give you the glory, to give you the honor that only you deserve. And we're thankful tonight. We're thankful tonight. My friends, praise him. My friends, give him the glory because God is good. Don't look at your troubles. Look at God. Don't look at the giants that surround you. Look at God. Trust him because he is bigger than those troubles. He's bigger than that giant. And you can't allow worry and stress to hold you down or get you down. Praise the Lord. You got to keep saying, my God is good. And I'm going to do what it says here in Psalms 4. I'm going to stand in awe of him. I'm going to stand in awe of him. I'm going to continue to give sacrifices to God. I'm going to sacrifice righteousness. And I'm going to put my trust in him. Praise God. I'm going to put my trust in the Lord. Is your trust in God tonight? This is something that we've got to continue to encourage each other with, that we put our trust in God. And when our brothers and sisters are low, we have to pray for them and encourage them. Continue to trust God. Continue to know that God sees your situation. God knows all things. There's nothing that is hid from him. Nothing that's hid from him. Look a minute in Psalms 5 and 11. He says, but let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. He said, all those that put their what? Their trust in him. All those are standing all before him. He said, put your what? Your trust. Your trust. Not in the world system. Not in the political arena. Praise God. Not even in your own flesh. But put your trust in him. And he said, and in him rejoice. They put their trust in him and they rejoice. Let them ever what? Shout for joy. Understanding that the joy of the Lord is what? It's your strength. The joy of the Lord. Your joy in God. The joy of knowing who he is. The joy of hoping in him. Knowing that all things that he has said stand fast. They stand sure right now. There's no failure. There's no failure in what God has said. You can stand on that. Men will make promises, and sometimes they try to hold to them, but they're limited. They're limited what they can do. We have a president. He's the president of the United States of America, one of the greatest nations on earth. But the thing about it, he's still limited. There's only so much he can do because he still has to go through others to get things rectified or brought through, praise God, or carried on. But we understand, listen, we have a God that is not limited. That he's not limited. He doesn't have to sit before a Senate. He doesn't sit before a Congress. He doesn't have to go before a judge. He doesn't have to do all those things. His laws cannot be amended. Praise God. His constitution cannot be changed because everything that God has declared and said, praise the Lord, is steadfast. Steadfast in heaven. So we've got to understand that, Lord, your word is steadfast. And I'm going to stand up on your steadfast word. I'm not going to allow the enemy to move me away from what you have said. Praise God. Because your word is written in heaven. It is settled in heaven. It has been declared in heaven. And we're going to stand up on it. So he says here, shout for joy because thou defendest them. See? He said, praise God. Why? Because you have a defender. It's God. It's God, the Lord of hosts. You have a defender, the Lord of hosts. He says, let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee. For thou, Lord, will bless the righteous. He's going to bless them what? With favor. Will thou compass them as with a shield? He said, you will compass them with a shield. You put a hedge about him. The favor of the Lord is around the righteous. The favor of the Lord is upon the righteous. Praise God. The righteous are what? Are blessed. Those are living righteous. Those are in right standings with God. You cannot allow things around you to determine your worship, determine your praise, determine if you're blessed or not. You know, cars don't mean I'm blessed. A house doesn't mean I'm blessed. All these things, they're okay, but they're not. Don't count them as the only blessings. the only blessing, if I get this, if I get this new job and all this, praise God, your blessing is knowing him. Your blessing is in knowing him. Praise God, your blessing is knowing that he is my father. Praise God. That's why Paul said in Romans 8, he said, if God be for you, who can be against you? He was letting them know that your blessing was in knowing him. If God be for you, what can be against you? He said, who can lay anything to the charge of God's elect? So regardless of what they were going through at that time and the situation that was upon them and the circumstances was upon the people of God, the early church, he says, if God be for you, who can lay anything to God's elect? Because he let them know, he said, God didn't withhold his son. He gave his son for you. How we? I give you all things. In other words, everything that God has declared, everything that God has said that he would do, God will do. You can stand on that. You can stand on that, praise God, because God is true to his word. God is true to his word. He is a faithful God, a faithful God. I've said before, God's word is totally dependable. I said it represents his permanent commitment to us. God's word, God is totally dependable. God's word is his permanent commitment. I mean, it can't be changed. It cannot be altered. He says in Isaiah 48, he said, the grass withers, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God. The word of who? Of our God shall stand forever. Because it is his word that meets the deep needs of my heart. It is his word that provides the joy and the satisfaction of my life. That's what we got to get in our mind. This is what we got to get in our heart. We've got the things before us that are things that are of the world and the things that are here in this life that we're living. And sometimes we look too much at them to give us joy. We look for them to give us peace. Praise God. And that's why when anything happens to those things, they're taken away, we fall into depression and we're ready to give up and we want to stop doing this and stop doing it. That's why we can't, our treasures can't be. Jesus said, you can't have your treasures on things on this earth. You can't have treasures. He said, if you put your treasure on things on this earth, that's something that's not going to last because the enemy can get to that. But you want your treasures where? In heaven, upon heavenly things. But enemy, well, he talked about the moss and the rust and the corrosion and all the things cannot touch, cannot get to. This is what we've got to understand, that we've got to live this way, giving heed to God. We were talking about having a heart that's heeding, a heart that desiring God. A heart that desiring God. Hebrews 2 and 1. Therefore, we ought to give the most earnest heed to the things which we have heard. At least at any time we should let them slip. We talked about this. At any time we should let them slip. And as a man of God, I'm seeing how they're slipping because we're moving away from what God desires. We want to put God in the form and the fashion that we would have him in. We want to worship God the way we want to worship. And that's not what God wants. We've got to have a mindset to say, you know what? I'm going to trust him. When it talks about this, praise God, it lets us know that there's no greater message, than what his son gave to us. There's no important message than the gospel, which the son has given. No greater message, the word, no greater message. For he says, if the word spoken by angels was steadfast and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense or reward, he said, how shall we escape if we neglect so what greater salvation? He says, which at the first begun to be spoken by who? The Lord. And was confirmed to us by them that heard it. It was once spoken by who? The Lord, the Lord's word. In other words, there's no greater message. than what was delivered by Christ. Men may preach messages and things of that nature, but that the greatest message has already been brought forth by Christ. Praise God. He said, there's no more important message than the gospel, which the Son has given. And he doesn't say that the law given through angels was steadfast, producing sure judgment. How shall we escape if we ignore the sure message of the Son? The sure message of the Son. This message was proclaimed by Christ to his apostles, and then by the apostles to the author of Hebrew. This thing was proclaimed from Jesus to the apostles, to the writers, and it's put here for us, for our inspiration. That's why it says, how are we going to escape if we neglect this? If we neglect this, you know what happened to things when you neglect them? When you don't take care of them, they fall apart. They get raggedy. They'll lose their youthfulness because you of what? You neglected it. Praise God. You're not doing the things that's necessary to keep it strong, to keep it together, to keep it in working order. That's why we got to understand. That's why I say you got to give heed, careful attention. You got to pay attention. Pay attention to the word. Pay attention to your heart. Pay attention to your mindset. The Bible said that not to be conformed to this world. And I said before, when it talks about that in Romans 12, 1 and 2, that conformity is a subtle thing. It's a subtle thing. It's very subtle. You move away from the things of God and still think you're standing where you should be. That's what the enemy will do. He's subtle. And we've got to understand, we've got to be able to stand and fast in the word of God that we can stand against the subtlety of the enemy. That's why the Bible says you put on the whole armor, that you can stand against what? The wiles of the devil, the cunning, the craftiness, the strategy. The devil, listen to me, the enemy is a strategist. He is a strategist. Praise God. And we've got to understand, in order for us to stand against his strategies, we've got to have the word of God in our heart. We must position ourselves under divine authority. This is the position we got to have. It's under what? Under the divine authority of God. We got to come under divine authority. This has to be a willing mind, a sacrificial mind. I want to come under your authority, God. Whatever you say, whatever you need me to do, I'm going to do it. It takes sacrifice. Look at it for a minute here. It says to us in 2 Thessalonians 2 and 13, he says, but we are bound. Paul speaking here, he said, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you to what? To salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. He said he called us what? Unto salvation. Through sanctification. How did sanctification come? It came from the Spirit. It came from the belief of the truth. Sanctification came from the Spirit. It came from the belief of the truth. Praise God. Wherefore, he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it came through what? Sanctification. Sanctification talks about us being set apart for the use intended by his designer. We've been sanctified. God sanctified us through his Spirit, through his truth, so he can use us. Now we have become what? Meat. Profitable for the master's use. Now God can use us. God couldn't use me in the sinful state that I was in. God couldn't use me in the sinful state that I was walking in and living in. He couldn't use me because my mind was not on serving God. My mind was on serving the needs of my flesh. Walking, it's like Ephesians 2 tells us. We was walking in the course of this world. We was walking in the lust of our flesh. All I mind was about meeting the desires of my flesh. What did my flesh want? I'm going to do. But he says here that we've been sanctified, set apart for the use of the designer. Who's the designer? God. God is the designer. He's the designer. So he set us apart, sanctified us, holy, separate. We're distinct because God has set us apart for him. This is what Paul is saying here. He said, listen, you are distinct. He said, 13, I'm going to read it again. He said, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, treasure of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you. You're distinct. He's chosen you. He's chosen me. He's chosen you through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. He says, whereunto he called you by our gospel, to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, 15, he said, therefore, 2 Thessalonians 2:15, say, therefore what? Brethren. Therefore, people of God, stand what? Stand fast. Hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or epistle. He said, hold on to the things that have been taught to you. Hold on to the things that God has spoken. The things that have been written. The things that have been spoken to you. He said, hold on to those things. Hold on to it, praise God, so you can stand fast. That's the same thing we say in Hebrews. That's what he's talking about. The same thing here. Give heed to it. Don't let it slip. Hold fast to the things that have been spoken, the things that have been said unto you. Understand who you are. Look what he says. We've been unique because God has sanctified us to be his what? His people. To be his people. Now, 16, now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, which has loved us, and has given us everlasting consolation and good hope to God. Comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. He say what? He comforts your heart. He establishes you in every good word and work. God is the one that establishes you. God is the one that's going to keep you. God is the one that's going to keep pouring into your mind, pouring into your spirit, that you can do the things that God has said. This is why I'm saying to you that we've got to position ourselves right. Positioning is everything. In a battle, in a warfare, positioning is everything. We're fighting war on two fronts. We have a spiritual war that we're battling in. And we have a flesh war that we're battling in. Our flesh and mankind, we're battling. And that's why you got to be in the right position to be victorious. We got to be in the right position to be victorious. And that's why I'm saying you got to position yourself on the divine authority, because it's saying here that you've been called. I've been called by divine authority. Hallelujah. So I got to be living and moving by the anointing. I got to be living and moving by the anointing. It means we are consecrated, are made sacred. You talk about the anointing, being anointed. You've been consecrated. You've been made sacred. We have been anointed to do a work. We have been anointed to serve God. He says, we read, living and moving in and by the anointing. We walk in, we're living on divine authority, and we're living and moving in the anointing. It means we are consecrated, made sacred, or dedicated to the service of God. I as well be dedicated to what? To the service of God. Dedicated. My mind, heart, dedicated to the service of God. It is the anointing that changes you. Gives you God's vision. It gives you God's purpose. It gives you God's perspective. It's the anointing that does the changing in your life. It's the anointing that destroys the yoke. It's the anointing, praise God, that gives you a changed perspective, give you a different mindset. The Holy Spirit in my life is the thing that gives me the perspective of God, gives me the purpose of God, gives me God's vision. Hallelujah. I just want us to grab tonight the blessedness that's upon our lives. The Bible said it gives us the perspective. Look at St. John 16 and 13 right quick. St. John 16 and 13. We're talking about it gives you God's vision. It gives you God's perspective. It shows you purpose. St. John 16 and 13 said, how be it when he, the Spirit of truth, the anointing, is come, he will guide you into all what? Truth. When he comes, it's going to guide you into God's perspective. It's going to guide you into God's purpose. It's going to guide you into all, not some, but all truth. It's going to show you the truth. That's what I love about this, because I don't have to worry about men showing me the truth. I don't have to worry about a Republican, Democratic Party, Independent Party, whatever, trying to show me the truth. I can see the truth through God. Understand that the truth is in him. The truth is in him. Because our world is full of lies and hypocrisy. We have to stand on the truth of God. If not, we will slip away. If not, we will be deceived. Because the Bible says to us in 2 Corinthians 4 and 4 that the enemy is the devil is the god of this world, small g. And he's deceiving the minds of many. We will fall into that deception if we don't stay focused on our God. If we don't hide this word in our heart. If we don't stand true. So he says to us here, howbeit he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever even he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. That's what I'm saying. We got to get the position, get in the divine position, because I want to hear from heaven. I want to hear from God. I want to hear the things that I need to do and how I need to walk. We pray. And prayer shouldn't be just a thing where we get on our knees and tell God everything we want. We should get out and say, Lord, I need to hear from you. Early I'm going to seek you because I need to hear from you. I need you to speak to my heart, Holy Spirit. I need you to guide me. I need you to lead me this day. I don't know which way to go. I don't know what to do. God wants to keep you from being and keep me from being conflicted and confounded. He no longer wants us to walk in confusion and doubt and discouragement. If we're walking in this today, then we'd allow things to slip away. He brought us out of this world, the world mindset, the secular system of Satan. And that's why I'm saying you got to know the truth, because the enemy wants to mix it. He wants to mix the secular with the spiritual. That's why we can't mix the secular with the spiritual. This is why it's so imperative that people understand what the word of God says, that God is a holy God. He's a holy God. And we're going to serve him. We've got to serve him in the mindset, in the spirit of holiness. You can't, if you're going to serve it, holiness, and it's going to be pure, it's going to be righteous, you can't mix it with the world. God doesn't need anything of the world to do what he's got to do. You don't mix it with that. When he brought him out of Egypt, he told him and said, do not mix yourself with the heathen nations. Deuteronomy 7. Don't mix yourself with the heathen nations. Don't marry them. Don't have nothing to do with them. Don't make covenants with them. Because he knew by them doing that, it was going to defile the perspective. It was going to defile their purpose. Because they would begin to take on the characteristics of these heathen nations. You can't defile yourself with this, because if you defile yourself with the things of this world, you're going to take on that mindset again. You're going to take on that mindset again because the flesh is weak. It always wants to go back to where it was. It always wants to pull you back to that ungodly nature. That ungodly nature. That's why you understand I said you're in a battle, you're in a fight, you're in a warfare. This is why this flesh got to be crucified. That's why it's got to be crucified. You got to crucify it daily. Every day you got to get up and live this. Every day you got to get up and walk this, because there's so many things that's trying to stop you. Look what he says. He said, we'll lead and guide you. But whatsoever it hear, it shall speak, and he will show you things to come. He said, he shall glorify me. Saying this, the Lord, he shall glorify me, for he shall receive the things of mine. And he's going to show them unto you. He's going to declare them unto you. Praise God. He's going to manifest them unto you. Isn't that wonderful? He's going to declare my things unto you. I want to hear from God. I want him to continue to declare himself unto me. That's why I want to continue to walk with him. That's why going to church is not enough. If all you got is on Sunday, you're in trouble. Because that's not enough to keep you. If your faith is just wrapped up in Sunday service and what happens on a Sunday, then you don't even have any faith. Because once you leave out the door, if that's it, that's all you got. That's a place where we come to be encouraged. We come to exhort one another. We come to worship together. But we are, understand something, that's a building. We are the church. So that worship, that praise, should continue in our lives on a daily basis. On a daily basis. We should worship and praise God, giving him the glory. Not wait till I get here, wait till I get there, wait till the revival starts. We should be worshiping. We got to praise him before the world, before others, that they can see his glory, that they can understand that God is good. In the times that we're in right now, listen to me, people of God, you got to worship him. You got to worship on your job. You got to worship in your home, everywhere you go. We can't wait to Thanksgiving to be thankful. We got to thank him at all times. That's what he says. And then we're going to close. He shall glorify me. I love that. He shall glorify me. For he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. Put that in your heart tonight. All things that the Father has, listen, are mine. He said, I'm going to take my things and show it to you. And the things that he shows to you are things of the Father. He said, and all things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, said I, that he shall take of mine, wow, and shall show it unto you. This is why we must position ourselves under divine authority. We got to live it. We got to walk it. We got to move in it, in this anointing. Praise God. We'll stop here and we'll try to finish it. Lord, say the same Sunday morning. If you get a chance to tune in, praise the Lord at 11 o'clock Bible Church, and we're going to carry on with this. I want you to get excited about God, get excited about his glory, get excited about his presence, get excited about the things that he's doing in your life right now. He has not forgotten us. And listen to me, he will never forsake you. He will never leave you. And I'm so happy about this. I've been walking with him for a number of years, and I thank God that he's never forsaken me. In my down times, he's never forsaken me. In my off times, he's never forsaken me. When I've been stupid, he's never forsaken me. So we praise him tonight. We thank him tonight. Let's pray. Father God, we bless your name. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We give you praise for all that you are. Let your word continue to move in our hearts and minds, that we can be what you're calling for in these last days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm Pastor Losa. I love you tonight. Keep worshiping.
that weaves thrown in tears.